Welcome everyone to morning call 21 of Let's Do This. I think we're like a month in already. Love it. Yesterday we had over 100 people with Levon, like 111. We have Carlos, my brother. I really, you know, he's a brother of mine. You know, we've been friends since inception. I call him the tax wizard. He's helped me save so much in taxes, helped me, you know, never been audited. Thank God. I don't need to knock on wood because he's the wizard. He's Gandalf the Grey, the wizard. The tax person. He's been Lifestyle's number one go-to forever. Carlos, welcome.
Yes, sir.
Give us a little introduction about yourself, your life. You know, I know you got the Hialeah roots too. Talk to us.
Negative. No Hialeah roots. Born and raised in Miami-Dade. Obviously, I appreciate everyone, you know, for allowing me to be on this call. Obviously, there's always a negative stigma as far as tax, and obviously tax is a little bit boring, but I've taken a lot of the approach of consulting and advisory services. So I get approached a lot with how do I do this? How do I write things off? So, you know, one of the most important parts are obviously the incorporations of how important it is to incorporate yourselves, whether being an LLC, whether being a PA, the proper structure. You know, I'm not going to name prices here. I don't want to kind of go down that rabbit hole for everyone, but for the most part, obviously, discount Lifestyle Agents does get discounts for incorporations, accounting services as well, which is one of the most important things for us to be able to analyze and properly estimate your tax liability, see how you can save taxes and so forth. So I want to leave it more kind of like an open Q&A because I do tend to get a lot of questions on how to do things, how to write things off, how to take advantage of bonus depreciation and so forth. So, I mean, with that being said, I opened the firm. I've been doing this for 15 years, opened my firm back in 2013. And obviously it's something I love to do. I'm actually an entrepreneur. So I have multiple ventures, online e-commerce. So I'm pretty diverse in everything. But, you know, with that being said, it's, you know, nowadays it's all about how to save taxes. How can I mitigate taxes as much as possible? Whether we're doing incorporations in Delaware for fictitious purposes, whether you have potential investors that want to purchase property, the proper structure it's imperative for tax purposes, for liability purposes and so forth. So, I mean, it's investment properties. I've helped actually George himself in the last couple investment properties. Proper structure, proper cost segregation analysis, how to, you know, get the cost segregation analysis.
Let me chime in there because, sorry, and Carlos, it's because I could kind of pick the mind of like, so like I could kind of give you I know where a lot of these realtors are now. Make note that we have North Carolina, we have Jersey agents that still can't open PAs. Next year, they're going to allow to do what we do in Florida. And I'm not too sure with North Carolina. I know I got Sean Gerald, you know, on there in Sriracha. I don't know if they could get paid directly to a corporation like we can in Florida, but they are going to be doing this in Jersey. So now, Carlos, we could do taxes for people here in Jersey for the corporation. But one of the things that I'll tell you, and there's a lot of investors here. Sir Ashley's in here. Sean, there's a lot of people that buy properties here. What you did for me last year to kind of save so much money in taxes. Could you explain that, the cost segregation, depreciated appreciation? Because I had no idea of that. If you could kind of explain
that. Yeah, of course. Absolutely. So to chime in on your initial question. So what a lot of people don't know, whether you do get paid in your, well, you do pay, get paid for XYZ laws in each state as far as getting paid to an LLC or getting paid to a PA. There's always called what's pass-through entity reporting. So whether you get paid under a 1099, where you get issued out under 1099, you under an operator receive these deposits under your entity, then we're able to issue out a 1099 from an individual onto your corporation because the activity happened in the corporation. So you can mitigate tax on the self-employment side by just making sure if that is an option that you don't have, getting paid directly to the PA, getting paid that 1099 under your name, but and then passing through that income over to your corporation.
I just mean to go ahead. Go ahead.
I'm sorry. So where did you guys lose me at? Sorry.
Oh, no, because somebody had unmuted, but getting paid through the pass-through.
Right. So getting paid as an individual for whatever reason, obviously Florida usually does not have that option. But as you were saying, New Jersey or North Carolina, whatever other state that has that stipulation that they cannot get paid under a PA or an LLC, pass-through entity is very common. You know, you own and operate the entity and the revenue is received in that entity or passed through that entity. Then in this case, we can push those earnings from an individual level to your corporation, then bring it back through. So that's something that we're very privy to and that we do very, very often. You know, for individuals that operated under their name, however, they had an LLC or incorporated previously on that current tax year.
Carlos, I'm going to give you a chime because, you know, this is the problem. You know, me and Carlos, this is the problem with tax people, right? They don't got the lifestyle flow yet. So we got to keep them how we do these questions. We know what the people want. Carlos is that accounting guy. I could tell you guys, there's two things in life until I met Carlos I hated. I looked at tax guys like dentists, something you gotta do, but you're like, damn, I gotta go do the cleaning. And again, some people are gonna say, oh, I love doing cleaning. No, yeah, you got great teeth, but of course nobody likes the cleaning and nobody likes to go pay taxes. But after I met Carlos, he made that more pleasurable, right? Like in the sense of like, it was a little bit more, I always like, ah, but now I always look at it like when I tell you guys, when you pass those benchmarks, you know, paying taxes back is always now a great thing, right? Because you're like, damn, imagine, you know, if I didn't have to pay his taxes, how worse off I was at. Like, I don't look at it like, oh my God, like I used to before. Now I look at it like, bro, if I paid X amount in taxes, I mean, I made X amount. Carlos, one of the things I am shocked and perplexed. And I hope Ellie's on this call because I was like guilting her. I was like, how could you not? And by the way, Carlos, North Carolina can do pay to a corporation. So we're good there. Just confirmed it. So I look at Ellie or anybody in Jersey, we had to find ways to do it and we're going to be ready, that don't open a PA. My brother this year that does his taxes, and Jessica's on this call. She was part of taxing as well. She, as you guys all know, she's one of our like commission bookkeeping people. My brother was so shocked that it was W-2. And again, it's crazy for realtors to think like, you know, your business can run a loss a little bit, but sometimes what is your tax rate compared to getting paid to your social security, like a normal realtor gets paid, like Ellie's been getting paid for the last 7 years. I couldn't believe she doesn't have a corporation compared to if they open an individual LLC PA. What are the difference in savings that why they need to do this like today? And this isn't a pitch, guys. I want you to keep more of your money. You make the same amount of money and we report it. You just keep more of your money.
Right. So right off the back is 15.3%, which is Social Security, Medicare, and self-employment tax. So right off the back, you're already saving 15%. Now, you know, a lot of small businesses, a lot of PAs and a lot of entities, they're structured and taxed as an S corporation. It is imperative to put yourselves on payroll. 98% of you guys don't, but IRS is going to start looking at this because what happens if you don't pay yourself on payroll, which is a reasonable salary? Bizstats.com is a website you can go to check what a reasonable salary is. But you have to pay yourself on a reasonable salary because IRS can revoke your S-Corp status. When they revoke your S-Corp status, you're revoked for up to 5 years. So that can definitely be a problem. So, you know, a lot of the times is, you know, we see obviously these corporations, these LLCs, these PAs, they don't pay themselves. They just pay themselves distributions, which is obviously one way to pay yourselves, but you have to put yourself on payroll. I want to definitely know that. Being obviously an LLC, you know, being an S corporation, structured an S corporation, 15% is immediately what you're going to save in taxes. But moreover, it's important about planning and structuring correctly. So, you know, I have some individuals that make $1 million in W-2 and I tell them, okay, I need you to exempt the whole year, do not pay any taxes because we're going to purchase an investment property. With this investment property, we can do a cost segregation analysis. Once we do this cost segregation analysis, we can save up to 20 to 30% of the initial assessed value and the interior breakdowns and everything of it in taxes. Now, the reason why it's important to take advantage of this is because effective, obviously, last year was the last year of 100% bonus depreciation. Now it's depleting 80% this year, 60% following year, 40%. And it's going to start depleting. So it's imperative to actually take advantage if an opportunity does come across on investment property. It's the best way for you, obviously, to save taxes. Obviously, there's the standard 6,000 pound vehicle weight, you know, the bonus depreciation on that. And, you know, the payroll, the obviously the 401ks, the SEPs, there's just so many ways that you can save taxes. But going back to what George was saying, cost segregation is an analysis done on an investment property that they pretty much break down the structural. You have a structural depreciation, whether being standard residential 27.5 years or whether it's been deemed commercial, usually 5 doors or more, you get 39 year depreciation. But then you have your interior breakdown. So anything that has a 15 year use life or less, this analysis will break down electrical, plumbing, roofing, appliances, everything down. Once this audited report is made available, then we're able to take a bonus depreciation based on that report. And then often, depending on the actual property and depending, obviously, the structural, you know, what did it need a large rehab and so forth, the average rate is about 30% that most taxpayers are able to save on an investment property. And then you obviously, on as you're starting to build a real estate portfolio, and then when you eventually going to fit that property, you have to go 1031 exchange. Otherwise, you have recapture tax, which is 25%. So there's a lot to it, but you know, obviously, we're here to help out. I'm very diverse in that field. Once you're able to explore, or once you're able to get into investment properties for yourself, or obviously your investors purchasing properties.
Love it, Carlos. One of the things that I'll tell you, and I know, like for example, Levon Beck, you know, amount of money he makes, he does bookkeeping. You do it for lifestyle, of course. You do it for all my corps, myself. And why should people keep good books, even as a realtor? Would you say?
Right. It's important to understand what your financials are, whether you do it yourself or whether you hire a firm like us to handle your accounting. You have to know where your numbers are at. You have to know what your estimated quarterly payments are. Right. So this month, actually prior month, we send out an email to our clients, essentially once there are certain net income levels. And then we send out an email to our clients, letting them know, hey, book an appointment with Carlos. Carlos and then can go ahead and help you, talk about how to save. You know, you don't essentially really have to, you know, the stigma is as far as like, oh, you have to pay quarterly taxes. Truthfully, IRS really don't know what your earnings are. You can make one estimate quarter payment a year and you're okay as far as in the IRS eyes. But for the most, it's important to understand what your net earnings are to be able, and obviously in this case gives us an analysis of your cash flow as well. But you have to understand where your books are. You have to understand, you know, where your numbers are in order to plan properly. If you don't know where your numbers are, you don't know how much money you're spending. We have no idea to how to help you tax plan properly. So it's important to have your books in order.
I love that. One of the things, Carlos, I would tell you, what about where I get this question asked a lot from realtors about like logging their miles. How does that work? Like how does miles, meals and entertainment, how is it this year? I know when COVID we had 100%, right? What is it now? Could you shed some light on that?
It's still 100%. I mean, you obviously have the standard traditional 58 and 100% meals and entertainment. Miles, it depends, right? So there's an app called Mile IQ, whether it's personal, whether it's business, you can swipe whether it's business. For most part, obviously, realtors usually, for the most part, it's, I would say more 80-90% miles driven for business. But there's also as far as like, hey, the vehicle is registered to my name. How do I properly write this off? So there's a reimbursement strategy. So if you're logging down your miles, you have a 54 cents deduction, 54 cents per mile deduction that the entity can reimburse the employee in this case for these mileage. So it's an employee reimbursement. Then you have obviously if you're going to take advantage of the bonus depreciation, and then there's specific adequate forms that you have to fill out from the corporation to the actual owner of this vehicle, in this case yourself, to be able to take the Section 179 bonus depreciation. But those are things obviously that have to be planned out. They have to be properly tracked. It's important when it comes to this, it's extremely important to actually document everything, because when the IRS, whether like, you know, George was saying, audits are very, very rare and he's never been audited, obviously, thankfully. But when IRS audits, the first thing they're going to ask for, obviously, is it's going to be record keeping. Let me see all your documentation, how organized you are. The more disorganized you are, the more they're going to come through. The more organized you are, they're going to say, okay, everything is ordered. Let's actually close this case out and move on to the next one. So documentation is imperative, guys. Whether, you know, there's so many ways you're going to travel, whether it's made for pleasure, you spend, I don't know, $5,000. Now, obviously, it's expensive with inflation, but make sure you turn that into a business. Go show a property, go do whatever, log that in a calendar, log that in anywhere. And then now you're able to make that travel that was initially for pleasure, you're able to turn that into a business expense. So little things like that's important, but it's important to make sure you document all your movements when it's a business related expense.
Carlos, another one. And actually me and Carlos, every time I get some funny memes, Marvin says every year when Carlos sends him the tax bill that he's going to move to Nicaragua and not pay his taxes anymore. So Marvin's going to move to Nicaragua any day now. But what did I tell you, Carlos? One of the things that me and Carlos were actually texting last night, and there's some crazy, I'm not going to mention the name, but some crazy maniac in Miami faking like, oh, we get texted this all the time as realtors. We get spam texts. Now we see people on social media, ECR credits, PPP things.
ERC.
Can you talk to us about it?
Yeah, ERC. So it's called the Employee Retention Credit. So I'm sure you guys heard it a lot. You know, there's the stigma out there. It's funny because he had shared something, a federal grant. Guys, it's not a federal grant. In order for you to qualify for the actual ERC, which is called an Employee Retention Credit, is you have to have had payroll, you know, retained employees in 2019, 2020. And then the IRS is reimbursing you for those wages up to $26,000 per employee. We've had clients qualify for $1 million, $2 million, obviously have really big operations. It's just a refund on your wages paid. Obviously, the caveat to that is you then in that turn have to amend your taxes because you're going to have a taxable liability. So you're getting a refund on your actual, on the credits, but in turn, you're going to have a tax liability. Obviously, the actual credits are going to completely supersede the actual, your liability. So it makes perfect sense to obviously do it. But there's a lot of people pushing the ERC and there's certain stipulations and qualifications for you to be able to qualify for it. I'm obviously hearing a lot about fraud on it, you know, saying that, you know, we can get it even though you didn't have employees. Absolutely not. It's fraud. People make up 941s and 940s, which is our payroll documentation with the Internal Revenue Service to be able to indeed qualify you for it. So just, you know, obviously stay alert to that. In order for you to qualify for an ERC, you had to have retained employees within the course of 2019 and 2020 to be able to qualify for an ERC.
All right, Carlos, another, somebody had a good question, and I always get this question asked. And Viviana is from Florida, so she goes, is it suggested for us to open a PA or LLC? And I know you could do George Cancer Bell PA or George Cancer Bell LLC. Is there any difference? That's a good question.
Right. So it's very common question that people use. When it comes to having a PA, it's you just have a little bit more leverage in writing off certain things, whether it's a life insurance policy, certain insurance policies that you're able to do it. Doesn't necessarily mean you can't on an LLC. It's just got to be properly done, whether you're putting yourself on payroll or you're paying yourself through certain aspects in that as far as life insurance, insurance in it itself. With a PA, you just have a little bit more wiggle room on that perspective as far as writing it off directly through the PA. But at the end of the day, most LLCs are structured as an S corporation for the simple fact of mitigating tax on the self-employment side. So, you know, I would say probably maybe but 97% of LLCs are structured to be taxed as a corporation. PAs are, they start off obviously as a C corporation, you have to elect them. A lot of people tend to, which is very, very common, guys, people incorporate, hey, I already opened a corporation, I did it in some business, it cost me X amount of dollars. You still have to file the adequate form to notify the Internal Revenue Service that you're an S corporation, which is form 2553. You have to properly do that. If you don't do that, then you're not elected as corporation and you come file your taxes, then we have to do what's called a retro late election with the Internal Revenue Service, meaning we have to tell them and justify to them why we did not elect S corporation status in 45 days of your election. So for the most part, very, very common when you tell us you're an S corporation and the actual paperwork doesn't show you, the EIN number, the SS4 does not show you whether you're an S corporation. You have to receive a letter from the IRS saying, I am an S corporation. You've been effectively elected as an S corporation such day. So we charge $250 to incorporate to file all the adequate paperwork. So that's obviously the lifestyle discount. So we'll get that all organized for you. And for the most part, obviously you have access to any questions that you may have for myself.
I don't know if this is serious, but if it's not serious, I love the question. Somebody goes, what about adding your kids as an employee? My son is 12 and he's good at that.
Very, 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 another good, great deduction. So obviously the timing is a mess. I don't know how much time you guys have, but depending obviously the structure, right? So the easiest and most efficient way to do it, because you obviously, if you're an S corporation structure, you have to pay your child out in through a W-2, right? So $12,950 is the actual maximum. Anything beyond that point, then it probably becomes a taxable, you know, you have to file an income tax for your child. But for the most part, the easiest and most efficient way to do it is you incorporate a single member LLC under your name. Then you have a management fee paid from your corporation to your LLC. Pass that income over. You do a monthly invoice over for consulting or marketing. And in that case, it's an expense to the business and it's a full write-off on the single member LLC side. That is the easiest and most effective way to do it. Some people put auto payroll every single month or auto transfer in this case, But guys, record keeping is the most important part of it. If the IRS audits you for this specific reason, then at this point you have to show them that your child was working for you in whatever area of the business itself. And it's got to be obviously a reasonable compensation. In this case, you can't just say, hey, he helped me out one day in the month, and then you paid him $1,000. So, you know, these are important things to make sure you note down.
Love
record keeping, guys. Record keeping is the most important thing.
I know Amanda has we got a couple more questions. Carlos, we have time. We usually try to do 30 minutes, but it could go
full. Not a problem.
More so if you got something. So Amanda had a question. She had her hand up. Did you have a question, Amanda?
Yeah, I did. I tried to text at the red light. Hi, good morning. Nice to meet you. Quick question regarding back to the PA versus LLC. So when you say you can write off life insurance policies, because I don't have a PA or an LLC, which is dumb, I know. But what does that mean? You can write off the life insurance policy, because I know you write off a bunch of different stuff.
Right. So in this case, it's certain term policies that you can, and I can obviously share information with George. You can share it with the entire team. But certain term policies, you're able to the PA is able to pay in behalf of its owner. Certain life insurance policies and health insurance policies. I'll share more information about this as far as like the type of policy that you can actually write off and the benefits of PAs versus LLCs. Not something that, like I said, you know, PA is the professional association. In order for you to be a PA, there's certain stipulation, obviously realtor falls within one. You cannot have somebody else also in a corporation that does not render the same services as a PA. I'm sorry, as a real estate in this actual joint venture. So I'll share a little bit as far as like what you could do as a PA versus an LLC. Doesn't necessarily mean you cannot do it in an LLC. It's just different parameters you have to take to be able to write that off when structured as an LLC, taxed as a corporation.
Okay, because I do have a term and an IUL. So I'd like to know more about that. Thank you.
Absolutely. No problem.
Another question was, I created the LLC, but I didn't elect it as S Corp. I opened last month. What is the form again to change to S Corp? Somebody asked.
So when you're an LLC, there's two forms you have to file, right? You have to file an 8332, which is entity classification to be taxed as a corporation. And then you have to file a 2553 together. If you did not do it by a specific time frame, for example, if you have not filed your taxes for 2022, that is, and you have an extension out, then you have to file retro election. So you have to notify the Internal Revenue Service, RevProc 213.30, and then RevProc 210.30, that you're retroactively electing it because you've obviously passed that 45-day threshold, and you have to notify them and you have to give them valuable reason as towards why you did not file that election.
All right. Another question. They ask, can you elaborate expensing business trips? What documentation is actually needed?
So record keeping, guys, once again. So let's say you guys go out for pleasure and a travel. And in this case, you want to turn this into a business expense, right? Like everybody really wants to do. So you go show a property, you go circle around, you say today you mark in your calendar. Or some type of notes. You mark in your calendar, gonna go see XYZ properties, gonna go prospect over here, gonna go have lunch with such and such person. Like you kind of like try to find the area or try to find, you know, real estate offices around, maybe where you can kind of network. Obviously you guys are privy to obviously networking everywhere you guys go. So turning that into a business trip by doing these things, maybe a couple hours a day, can definitely deem the pleasure travel into a business travel.
Let me ask this question. What if they take their broker and a couple agents? Is it a business trip?
Well, in this case, it's a 100% business trip. So, you know, you can turn, guys, and it's all about, you can turn anything into, not anything, but just for the most part, you can turn just about almost anything into a business expense. It's got to be justifiable. It's got to, you know, there's so many things as far as home office expense. How do I run off home office expense? There's certain criteria to be able to.
Can you talk about the home office expense? Because I'm looking at Gigi right now and she is in her home office and there's a lot of agents at our home office. If you could elaborate.
So in this case, home office expense, there's two ways to do this, right? You have your simplified version, which is the maximum you can run off of the home office expense is going to be 300 square feet, $5 per square foot with a maximum deduction of $1,500. That is a simplified route of home office expense. The other route is you have to get your entire square footage of your home, see how much square footage of the interior home is, and then you're going to start breaking down your rent, mortgage payment, utilities, and everything. And then you're going to actually be given a specific percentage in home office expense. This specific method is extremely high audit chance for the Internal Revenue Service. So it's just, if everything is properly calculated and measured and everything is noted, then it can definitely be written off. In this case, also there's certain measures. If you're a PA, obviously in this case, or you're in an LLC structured as an S corporation, then there's reimbursement clauses that you can actually add from the corporation to itself, giving the actual employee a reimbursement in that route.
Love it. Well, I saw Sergio's hand first and Gigi, but Gigi, ladies first. So Gigi, ask your question.
Thanks. Sorry, Sergio. just quick question, Carlos. Thank you. I just have a question about, I guess, owner's draw versus payroll. So right now I get paid to my LLC. I have a business checking and a business saving, and it doesn't matter what transaction it is, any transaction, whether it's a $30,000 commission or a $1,000 rental. As soon as it lands in my business checking, 15% of it, I put in my business savings. That's for taxes. And then a certain percentage in my business checking of that transaction, I transfer it manually via Zelle to my personal checking account. And so is owner's draw in that sense the same as payroll?
So are you an LLC structured to be taxed as an S, or are you an LLC single member?
I think right in this past year was single member. And this upcoming year, based on my profits so far, my CPA said, let's change you to an S corp.
Phenomenal. Okay. So in this case now, so previous year's fine, right? So as a single member LLC or a partnership, you take owner's draws. You don't put yourself on payroll.
Okay.
So you did that right previously. Now, current year, obviously you're structured now moving forward to be taxed as an S corporation. You have to pay yourself a reasonable salary. I'm sure obviously your CPA can tell you this is what we deem a reasonable salary. Mm-hmm. Realtors, obviously, it's always kind of like, how do I pay myself and so forth. I tell my clients, you know, let's start off at a certain base, at least, you know, do $15,000-$20,000 a year, put that on auto run, set it and forget it, pay yourself X amount a month. You can do bonuses every quarter. You can do bonuses annually to be able to tax plan properly. So there's a lot of things, but yes, in this case, if you're elected as an S corporation, you're supposed to pay yourself a reasonable salary, right? Which I just discussed. And then you can take distributions accordingly.
Okay. Distributions quarterly can be a draw.
Distributions weekly can be, you know, bi-weekly, can be monthly. It doesn't matter when you take distributions. It's essentially a draw from the business itself. But it's now listed as a distribution because you're now taxed as an S-corp.
Okay. So that's basically
pay yourself, payroll and distributions, because you're not going to run yourself. You're not going to pay yourself a substantial amount on W-2 because it's going to cost the business money at the end of the day, because the business has to match the employee's Social Security and Medicare tax. So it costs the business the approximate 11% to run payroll. So you don't want to pay yourself such a high amount on a W-2, because at the end of the day, it's going to cost business. As long as you are paying yourself a reasonable compensation and IRS can see on your 1120S that compensation to officer, there is a salary amount put on there, then at that point, that's fine for them. And then in this case, whatever the amount is on distributions, you're able to take based on your profits.
Okay, so you could do both. Essentially, the payroll needs to be something constant that's fair regularly, and then an owner's draw is something that, you know, if you have a little bit of extra money or whatever, you can take at any time.
Absolutely, 100%. Okay.
Thank you.
Of course.
Sergio.
Hey, Carlos. Gigi, it was all good. Carlos, quick question. Early on, you talked about being able to buy investment properties to be able to use a depreciation as a tax exemption. Does that investment property have to be under the same name of that corporation? Or can you just, as an owner?
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
Yeah, as an owner, you're able to take that the same depreciation as well, right? So same law still apply. The bonus depreciation, you're able to take that through obviously through a company side, through an LLC corporation, and you're also able to take that over as an individual level as well. Eventually, as you start building your portfolio, which I've helped structure a lot of people as well, is you have your main holdings entity. Your holdings entity is the one who pretty much it's going to, all the money is going to flow through. Then you have each entity below, whether it's a consulting agency or when you're receiving all your revenue, it's going to be owned by the holdings company. And then every time you acquire an asset, you're going to open an LLC. These assets, these LLCs are going to own these assets. And then eventually, these LLCs are going to be owned by the holding company. Eventually, then you're going to structure them a consolidated tax return. So you're going to notify the Internal Revenue Service that these LLCs, all this income is going to be passed through and is going to be reported on one entity. So as you continue to build out your real estate portfolio, you properly structure yourself, A, for liability purposes and as well for tax purposes.
Love it. Love it.
Thank you, Carlos.
No problem.
Carlos, another one, they said, when doing office expense, does that impact the income made from home when it's sold? Can you still do a 1031 exchange?
Yes, absolutely. It's just a deduction you're taking. The only thing that impacts your actual, your 1031 exchange are your initial cost basis. So it's important also if you do whether you take bonus depreciation, right? So let's say you purchase a property for $200,000, then you put $100,000 into it. Now you have a cost basis of $300,000. So in this case, if you take a bonus depreciation because you did renovations in any given year for a time, in this case, obviously when it's placed in service, so when you did the renovations, you're unable to use your cost basis of what you took in depreciation. So in this case, reverting, let's assume you put $100,000 into the investment property. You take a bonus depreciation on that, then you have to omit that at the time of your 1030 cost basis.
No. Carlos, we have another question and we'll have like three more. Do we put all our utilities in the business name or leave it at one or two utilities for it to qualify for home office, or is that not needed? What's the best way to claim it as a home office?
Well, it goes back to the method what I explained previously, right? It doesn't necessarily have to be under the business, but what portion of the home are you using for utilities? And then in this case, you're going to do the breakdown of the home office expense. But guys, remember, the home office expense, if you're structured as an S corporation, you cannot take a home office expense because where are you writing off this home office expense? The business is not writing it off, right? In order for you to write off the utilities, you have to have a proper location that you're renting out. And then at that point, you're able to take a utility. The best and easiest method to do so is on a reimbursement plan. So when you obviously, when the LLC is reimbursing the employee, in this case, that's how you're able to be able to take the deduction out.
Love it. All right. Another good one. Carlos actually helped me with this one. Two things. First off, I had bought many cars and I always ask Carlos, and most of the time I've always leased it. Like I bought an Escalade and I leased it. And then I was like at the dealership, they were like, didn't tell them about the corporation. Then I was like, do I put it in my corporation name for liability or not? Then somebody said, could you write them off as a business expense? But when could you write off your car as a business expense? Do you have to title it under the business? How does that work, Carlos?
So sometimes obviously very common question, right? Like they purchased for many reasons, right? You're obviously going to get a better rate when you finance this vehicle under your personal limit versus business name because now it's commercial. Then you have commercial insurance and so forth. Just because it's under your personal name does not necessarily mean you cannot write off the actual vehicle as an expense. Going back to what I originally mentioned, you can take an expense on the mileage. So in this case, you would record a mileage. The business would reimburse the employee, in this case, 54 cents per mile. And or you do what's called an enhanced expense vehicle reporting, which is a specific sheet that you would have the employee, in this case, obviously yourself, within the corporation itself, that you're going to take advantage of the bonus depreciation aspect of it. So you have this specific sheet, which obviously I can share it with you guys, this specific sheet and that you're going to take advantage of the bonus depreciation. There's certain stipulations. You have to, obviously the vehicle has to be used for 50% or more of business use in order for you to qualify for these deductions.
All right, that's a good one. And for Sergio's question, somebody wanted to follow up on the previous question. And Sean, I'll get you next. And we'll wrap that up on the last question for Sean. For Sergio's question, do you get a better break if you buy the house as a business versus yourself as the owner?
It's the same deduction. Are you talking about an investment property?
Mm-hmm.
So it's the same deduction that you're going to get when you do the cost segregation analysis and they're able to break down obviously everything else. That bonus depreciation is still going to take for why? Let's say you do it as an S corporation, right? As a corporation structure for the most part. In this case, it's all pass-through entities. Everything depreciation, everything is going to be reported on your personal income. I'm sorry, on your personal 1040. If it's purchased directly under your name for XYZ reasons, which I always highly, highly recommend you do an LLC, once again, for liability purposes, guys, it's always going to flow over to your personal Schedule E form. So whether it's purchased through a business or whether it's purchased individually, it's you're always going to take the same tax advantage.
Love it. All right, well, Barbie. Oh, sorry, Sean, you got outdued again. But you're horrible driving. Best, you know, Barbie, go ahead, but be careful because the longer you take, Sean's driving longer.
No. If I have an LLC. I would like to buy a car. Do you recommend buy it under my LLC name? I'd rather buy than lease. What would you recommend?
If the vehicle is once again going to be used for 50% more, then it also depends the vehicle, right? So how much is your vehicle payment? Whether it's a vehicle might be better off as a bonus depreciation, a reimbursement mileage. It's hard to actually say exactly what's the best route. In this case, realtors drive a lot. So you have to analyze, you know, how much mileage you have a year, right? So like most dealers are going to charge you an over mileage. So that might affect you down the line. They're going to charge you essentially mostly 25 cents per mile on every overage mile at the end of your lease. So you have to take that into account, whether it's right to actually lease or should I purchase this vehicle? So you have to analyze these things. If it's, let's say, a $300 monthly car payment, but you're able to get reimbursed more on a mileage perspective, then you're going to go that route, or a bonus depreciation. Bonus depreciation is $19,400 on vehicles. There's obviously a luxury vehicle depreciation cap, which is $50,000. But you're able to take the first year, $19,400, a little bit less than that. Guys, that was 100% last year. So you're on a $17,000 to $18,000 bonus depreciation first year. So purchasing or financing a vehicle might be the best route to go, but there's just so many factors of what's the best route to go, depending on the lease payments and so forth.
Under my LLC name, would you recommend?
So whether it's under your LLC, under individual, you can still take the same expense. Okay. You might get a better rate under an individual as far as when it comes to financing it. So probably it might be more advantageous individually. But I always obviously am very big on putting the vehicle under the corporation name. But there's also, there's also liability purposes that come along with that.
Thank you so much. Sorry, Chan. Carlos, again, can you drop
your... He's not driving anymore, so he's safe. Thank you.
Drop information so I can have a one-on-one with you. Thank you.
Okay. We're going to drop all his information, and then I'm going to share it in the chat as well, Barbie.
So Sean's last question?
Yes. Hey, Carlos, nice to meet you, man. Thank you, guys. So I'm asking a question for another agent here in Charlotte. She took a trip down to Florida last month. Initially, it was a cheerleading trip, but she took her niece. During that trip, however, she went to the lifestyle office to meet everybody in preparation to switch over to lifestyle for her firm. So her question was, since she did that, and she could prove she went on that trip, can she write off the car and the meals and all the things that went along with that trip as a business expense now?
Right. So proper record keeping is important. You can definitely turn it into a business trip. I just always emphasize it's important in the event of an audit, guys, that it's kept. I'm like, I traveled over here for pleasure, but in turn, I went ahead and did such and such. I showed properties. I went to a lifestyle office, and I'm going to deem this as a business expense. As long as it's properly kept in record, then at that point, in the event of an audit, IRS can deem it as a business expense. Audits are very, very rare, guys. I don't want you guys to freak out. Extremely rare, but nobody really knows as far as all these agents that they allocated resources for auditing and so forth. So I myself have seen very, very few corporate audits and personal audits a little bit more, but more on the lower income levels for children, claiming certain children, things like that. So audits, again, are rare, but it's important when the time comes that you're actually prepared.
All right.
Awesome. Thank you.
Sean, let's get at it. Carlos, this is what I'm leaving. Guys, don't disconnect yet. All right. Carlos, I know you get super bogged down, so I know you're going to have to, like, put, you know, Mike or somebody else. Guys, I'll tell you right now, Ellie, you're on this call. If you guys are not incorporated as a realtor, even if in Jersey, get ready for it. North Carolina, you could do it. The amount of tax savings you could, again, this is not a tax accountant or an accountant, honestly, you could go paying So you could save $10,000, $20,000, $30,000 a year in taxes at least by just having a corporation. If I paid you $100,000 to Lifestyle, right, to your Social Security, like Ellie might have made, she might have paid $30,000, $40,000, let's just say, in taxes if she doesn't have deductions. Now, if you had a corporation, it could be $10,000, $15,000, $0. If you had enough losses, it could be zero. Look at the tax saving. Again, this is just advice. Carlos, I need everybody in here to be incorporated. I need you to do something for them to make sure they file it right. Sometimes people will say, oh, I'm going to try to do it on my own to save a few bucks, but then they file it wrong. Then the end of the year, they didn't do the S-Corp. They didn't do anything. Carlos, what could you do for the realtors for that? And for the top producers, or not top producers, for the producers that are making money, bookkeeping service. And lastly, not only on price, who do they reach? I don't want them like to bog you down. So you got to have to tell me who they reach out so I can put it in the chat.
Right. Of course. $250 is to incorporate here in the state of Florida. If you're looking to incorporate in Delaware, it's $500, complete fictitious incorporation. That's an option as well that I definitely do offer. As far as accounting services, $300 a month, typically $325 for all Lifestyle. That's important if you guys don't do it on your own and you want us to handle the record keeping in that perspective. We obviously have an entire team, Alessandra, which is operations manager. She's the one who handles form communications, proposals, and so forth. You can filter the information through me, George, and then I'll go ahead and send it off to the team, whether it's Mike or whether it's myself, because it's Delaware Corporation, a little bit more complex. I have to take care of doing it. And in this case, for accounting purposes and payroll services, my team, Alessandra, Valeria, Ignacio, I have an entire accounting staff to be able to handle anything that has to do with accounting and bookkeeping.
All right, so perfect, guys. I'm putting Carlos's thing. I'm going to save this YouTube, send it to the brokers. Carlos, you'll get a bunch of emails. I'm not even putting yourself because I don't want.
Guys, I want to say this is a premium. Clients pay me huge retainers a month. We're talking about $10,000, $12,000 a month just to be their tax advisor. Obviously, these guys make a lot of money, but they just want me to hold their hand across the whole board of, I do not want to pay taxes. What do I got to buy? What do I got to do? What do I got to invest in so I make sure I don't give a dime to the Internal Revenue Service? And these people open up their wallets because if they have to pay the IRS, I saved this guy last year $1 million. If they have to pay the IRS $1 million and they'd rather pay me $150,000 a year to help them tax plan, they'd 1,000% do it. So just having the advice, just having access through me, through Lifestyle, through George, obviously our friendship, I'm more than welcome to help anybody out. I love helping people out. So feel free to reach out. I can kind of put pointers for you. I can tell you, this is what you can do. This is what you can't do. I'm very, very big on building a real estate portfolio. I can help structure that. And you know, just any questions, feel free to reach out.
Carlos, thank you so much, my bro. Appreciate you, brother. I'm going to expense my lunch with you at Hillstones and all the wine, because we're going to be talking about real estate. All right.
I'll document that. You're good.
Darling, bro.
Take care, guys. Have a good one. Bye now.
Let's do this.